After recording part one, I realized I kind of glossed over a few things, so I wanted to elaborate on some of the reasoning behind the decisions I made upgrade and hardware-wise. Before I migrated everything to my current single server solution, I was running two separate rack mount servers. I had the 4U Isilon NL400 running Windows 10 Pro as my storage server, and a 1U Intel S2600GZ Plex Media server also running Windows 10 Pro. The reason I had a separate transcode server was simply because I wasn't using hardware transcoding yet, and I needed to have those CPU cycles available for Plex without interference from other tasks or virtual machines running in the background. Plex can be very CPU hungry if you have multiple transcodes happening simultaneously. I think the advent of hardware transcoding really changed the game when it comes to running a media server at home. I think it's the best way to share with friends and family, and it can now be done fairly inexpensively. The 4U Isilon I had was running Stablebits Drivepool for both data redundancy and the drive pooling software itself. It worked great, like I said previously. I don't have anything against RAID 1 or Stablebits Drivepool. The selling point for Stablebits Drivepool really is that it's a software RAID, and unlike RAID 1, your data is still accessible even if you pull a drive out and put it in another computer. It copies every file in the pool to two disks. The only reason I continued using this product with 20 plus drives was out of necessity. In order to migrate away from it, I would need an array or pool large enough to house all of the data I already had in order to migrate it over. When I first installed the software, I only had two drives. It made sense back then, as I didn't see my storage addiction getting out of control like it did. As I continued adding drives, the ease of use and ability to add drives on an ad hoc basis, regardless of size, was great. But the hidden cost of this was getting vendor locked into a piece of software. I personally think Freenas and Unraid are better solutions because the way they work is fundamentally different. And at a high level, this allows you to get the most bang for your buck by sacrificing fewer disks to get the same data recovery ability. Take Unraid for instance. Sure, you sacrifice at least one drive as a parity drive to have single failure protection, but that can essentially protect you from any single drive failing and still being able to recover your data. If you lose a data drive in Unraid, you simply rebuild the entire thing by having one dedicated parity drive. In my opinion, this is a very elegant solution and it scales incredibly well. If you have four disks, for instance, and they are all 8 terabytes in size, you can sacrifice one 8-terabyte drive and have 24 terabytes of usable space in your array. Hell, you don't even have to have equal sized drives with Unraid, so you can have a mixture of 8, 5, 4, or whatever size drives you want as long as your parity disk is equal or larger than any of your data drives, and you end up with single drive failure protection at a minimum. Freenas uses ZFS, and while I don't want to turn this into a comparison video between the two, Freenas requires you to have equally sized disks for each array, or you have to create separate VDEVs to use different sized disks in a single pool. That also means sacrificing one drive from each VDEV for drive failure protection. If this isn't a deal breaker for you, Freenas does offer better read and write performance than Unraid, albeit with different pool/VDEV disk requirements. But with M.2 drives being as cheap as they are, you can just add an M.2 drive as a cache in Unraid and get pretty good performance out of it. And this is how I ended up where I am today. It had both to do with the desire for a more reliable storage solution, as well as the advent of hardware transcoding. Migrating from the loud as hell 1U S2600GZ Intel server and the 4U Dyson vacuum cleaner that I had to a dual-purpose storage and Plex transcode server really was a no-brainer. In Unraid, you can run virtual machines and pass a GPU through directly to a VM, which allows you to use hardware transcoding inside of a virtual machine on your storage server, which really lets you get the most out of a single machine. This is my current server. The foundation of my server is a Gigabyte GA7PESH2 dual socket LGA 2011 motherboard with dual E5-2690 V2 CPUs, two PCI Express LSI SAS 2008 expansion cards flashed to IT mode, 256 gigabytes of DDR3 ECC memory, and an NVIDIA GTX 1070 for Plex transcoding, and a total of about 117 terabytes of storage, of which about 96 terabytes of that is usable. I built this in a slightly modified Thermaltake Tower 900 case. I removed the plastic OEM feet and added casters on the bottom so that I could wheel it around when I need to move it. I mounted the GPU in the front of the case due to heat as well as some space issues. Overall, the case makes very little noise, runs fairly cool, stores lots of data, and is capable of roughly 46 H.265 transcodes as a Plex server, all while housing 117 terabytes of storage. I mounted most of the disks back here. I also added fans in the back to bring more air into the back of the case, as well as to create positive pressure, which helps exhaust the heat out through the top of the case and through the hard drives. I think it looks good, and it is a practical enough solution to run in a house. Modifying the Tower 900 case to fit an SSI-EEB EATX motherboard like the Gigabyte 7 Pesh 2 required drilling and tapping a few extra holes to add three motherboard standoffs. The entire process was pretty easy. The motherboard would have fit without these extra holes, but in my opinion, these extra standoffs here give it the necessary support for adding and removing memory later. After this, as I mentioned previously, I installed the drive cages in the back of the case, along with the extra fans. If you aren't already familiar with the LSI SAS 2008 cards, they allow you to add 8 drives with each card by using these breakout cables, which I also linked to in the description. SAS to SATA breakout cables are what I ran to the back of the case to get a total of 15 3.5 inch drives into this case. As I had mentioned in my previous video, this is my 4U Isilon server. As you can probably imagine, the noise this thing creates makes it almost unbearable to run inside your house. When I wanted to move it out of my garage due to humidity concerns, I needed to build something quiet that could house all of my disks, and that is how I ended up here. As I stated previously, I used to have two servers, one for Plex and one for storage. This allowed me to have dedicated CPU cycles and hardware for Plex, but due to the advent of hardware transcoding, passing a GPU through to a virtual machine inside of Unraid allows me to run a single server, which helped me lower my power bill each month. While I don't need the dual 2690 V2 CPUs to get the most out of this GTX 1070, I ended up buying them for the extra bit of headroom and to be able to spin up and tear down different virtual machines for lab purposes. Here is my Unraid dashboard with all of my Docker containers, VMs, storage, and hardware stats. As you can see, I'm running quite a few Docker containers. Most of these are spun up on an as-needed basis, while a few Docker containers are part of a Grafana dashboard that I use to monitor my server. Here are the VMs running on my server as of today. I have a primary Ubuntu Plex media server where I pass the GTX 1070 through to the operating system. This configuration allows me to get about 46 H.265 to H.264 transcodes. As you can see, the utilization on average is nowhere near that, but it's fun to have all that extra headroom. I think you would be hard-pressed to build something equivalent to this performance-wise with just CPUs today. I also run a Windows 10 Pro virtual machine. I use that for various applications and just to have a Windows host that's always up. Here is my main Grafana dashboard. This is running inside of a Docker container in Unraid. There is a great tutorial on how to build this in the description below. At the top of this dashboard, you can see my summarized UPS statistics, where I have the current load, battery charge, daily, yearly costs, as well as load versus time charts. Below that, I monitor each individual 2690 V2 CPU, the Ubuntu and Windows VM CPU utilizations, and the NVENC and GPU utilization inside of Ubuntu to keep track and, if necessary, help correlate any performance issues. The total CPU package, as well as the temperatures of my GPU and CPU, are on the right, and a current UPS runtime and GPU fan speed graph are below that. I track current transcodes and Plex sessions, as well as overall data consumption, growth, and free space. Some of the more useful statistics are the drive temperatures, cache, and array read-write speeds, as well as a disk latency and write times. That about sums up my primary dashboard. I have a few others as well, but the more interesting and relevant to this video would be the Ubuntu dashboard. Here I monitor current transcode speed, number of transcodes, PCIe receive and transmit data rates, GPU fan speed, and VRAM used, as well as the overall utilization of the NVENC chip. this dashboard really makes it easy to monitor Plex. To sum all of this up, the Tower 900 case really allowed me to run my Plex and storage servers inside my house and out of my garage, away from the humidity which kills hard drives. It also allowed me to virtualize my Plex server and lower my electricity bill. Thank you for watching, please like and subscribe. Let me know what your build is in the comments below, where it lives in your house, what the specs are, maybe take a photo and upload it. I'm really curious to know what others are doing out there.